In this video, I'm going to explain how motors work. Electric motors consume around half of global electricity. They're responsible for about 70% of industrial power consumption. There are different types of motors used in AC and DC power systems. DC brushless motors are very popular for use in electric vehicles because of their high torque and efficiency. AC motors use alternating current and are much more common. They make up most of the motor load I mentioned earlier, being responsible for about 70% of industrial power consumption. In this video, we will focus on AC motors, and even more specifically, three-phase asynchronous AC induction motors. Motors are part of our everyday lives. We use them in refrigeration condensers, AC units, hair dryers, and the list goes on. Have you ever wondered what makes a motor spin? We know it's electricity, but what really goes on inside the metal case that contains the motor? First, let's do a physical breakdown of a motor's layout. Key components of induction motors are the metal case that contains all the parts of the motor. On the outside of the case is the termination box where the wires come in to provide three-phase electric power to the motor. The wires go inside the motor case and are attached to the stator coils. The stator does not physically touch but is magnetically coupled to the next component, the rotor. The stator remains stationary and the rotor rotates. The rotor, sometimes called the armature, is the moving or rotating piece of the motor that provides the mechanical power output to the load through the shaft. Notice the shaft has a key set to ensure it doesn't slip inside the load sleeve. A key sits in here, which then links up with the keyway on the load side, whether that's a fan or a pump. For large motors, there may be a coupling that attaches the shaft to the load. Motors usually have one or more lifting eyes for hoisting. This is particularly important for very heavy industrial motors. And finally, we have the nameplate. This provides all of the necessary electrical and mechanical information about the motor. We'll do a breakdown of the nameplate later on in this video. But first, what makes the rotor spin? For a three-phase motor, the electric power energizes the three stator coils, one for each phase. These coils are evenly spaced around the stator, 60 degrees apart for a four-pole machine. Three phases alternating 120 degrees apart electrically results in a rotating magnetic field. This magnetic field induces a current on the conductive squirrel cage rotor. This is where the induction motor gets its name. The current that flows through the squirrel cage produces a magnetic field that opposes the magnetic field produced by the stator windings. These magnetic fields will oppose each other just like the north poles of these magnets will oppose each other. But because the fields are spinning, we get a rotation in the rotor. We have a demo here at the PSEC to help you visualize the magnetic field interaction. The stator field is rotating and you can see that it pushes a magnet and makes it spin. This mechanical torque is connected through the motor shaft to fans and pumps in industrial systems for air conditioning, water treatment, and a whole bunch of other industrial processes. The electricity is oscillating at a speed of 60 Hz or 60 cycles per second when it energizes the stator. The resulting mechanical speed of the rotor is a little less due to losses and the induction process, and the difference in speed is called the slip. For a four-pole machine, this equates to just under 1,800 revolutions per minute. AC motors run at a fixed speed when directly connected to the electrical system. To change the speed of a motor, a variable frequency drive is needed. Soft starters can be used to slowly bring the motor up to rated speed. When you start a motor without a drive or a soft starter, there is a large inrush current that can cause voltage drop and other issues on the nearby power system. This inrush or power is needed to overcome the inertia of the motor and the physical load attached to it. This is like spinning someone on a merry-go-round. It's hard to get them spinning. You might even run around in a circle a few times while pulling on the bar, but once they're up to speed, it's easy to keep them moving by pushing on one of the bars as it goes by. A typical motor inrush current when started across the line, meaning directly connected to the 60 Hz power system, is 6 to 8 times the rated full load current. Another thing to note is that some motors run at 3600 RPM, and that is actually a two-pole machine which has a different stator winding structure. The design of the rotor is very important to how the motor will operate mechanically. Most induction machines have what is called a squirrel cage rotor, made up of axial conduction bars and radial shorting rings. This is where the name squirrel cage rotor comes from. The stator will magnetically induce current on these bars and rings, which will produce the rotor's magnetic field. The shape and size of the conductors are modified to minimize starting currents or vary the speed and torque relationship. A wound rotor can be used instead of a squirrel cage for high starting torque but requires brushes and commutators. Induction machines are the most common industrial motors because of their simple and rugged design that can maintain constant speed across their load range. Motors come in all different shapes and sizes for various applications where certain torque and horsepower ratings are required by the load. Torque is the force the motor can apply, and horsepower is the speed at which the force can be applied. For example, an elevator needs a high torque in order to lift itself and the people inside, but it doesn't need a very high horsepower rating because it doesn't move very fast. A high horsepower elevator would be more like an amusement park ride. Compare this to a large industrial pump that spins very fast, pumping 1,000 gallons per minute. This is an application of high torque and high horsepower. The design of the stator windings and squirrel cage rotor is varied to allow for more current flow and induction to create more or less mechanical torque and horsepower output of the motor. Motors come in industry standard frame sizes set by IEC or NEMA. This allows motors to be easily replaced regardless of manufacturer. Because of this, you will only have to replace the motor and not a fan or pump when there is just a motor failure. Motors have a nameplate like this to display the necessary electrical and mechanical information for a technician or engineer. Let's take a closer look at the nameplate. This steel or aluminum plate is engraved to make the information readable for the life of the motor. Here in the US, nameplate information standards are set by NEMA, the National Electrical Manufacturers Association, but manufacturers may include other information to help with installation, operation, and maintenance of custom motors or those manufactured for specific purposes. The nameplate will list the frame designation for the mounting dimensions, the manufacturer's type, which tells the function of the motor, the power or horsepower rating is also listed. A good rule of thumb is that 1 horsepower is about equal to 1 kVA. Here is a list of commonly used equations for motor calculations. There is a time or duty rating, which is how long the motor can run at rated load. Usually, you'll see CONT, meaning that it can do so continuously. Also, you'll see the max ambient temperature for the surrounding environment that the motor can be in. There is an insulation designation given by a letter A, B, F, or H. The higher the letter is in the alphabet indicates the windings can withstand a higher temperature for longer periods of time. Another important spec is the service factor, which is an overload rating. At nameplate voltage and frequency, the allowable overload for a motor equals the rated load multiplied by that service factor. Such operation, however, will adversely affect efficiency, power factor, and temperature rise. This is only allowed for a short period of time, which is not specific even in the NEMA code. The best plan for an application needing temporary overload is to have temperature monitoring to ensure the motor does not exceed insulation temperature ratings. Operating over a service factor of 1.0 for extended periods will shorten the life of the motor. Service factors over 1.0 can be used to compensate for low or unbalanced voltage supply. The service factor is a complicated specification, and I recommend consulting NEMA MG1. The service factor is only required on a nameplate if it is higher than 1.0, so it's safe to assume 1.0 if you don't see the service factor listed. Also on the nameplate is the speed, which is given at rated load or horsepower. Remember, this is slightly below the electrical speed because of the magnetic slip interaction between the stator and rotor. As you can see here, this motor is rated at 1755 RPM instead of 1800 RPM. The electrical frequency is listed, typically 50 or 60 Hz. Because motors are being paired with VFDs more and more, this is sometimes listed as a range. Consult the motor manufacturer if you need to find out the range for use with a VFD. Notice that this motor actually lists the max safe mechanical RPM of 3600, which means that it could be fed a 120 Hz voltage by a VFD. The motor might also say inverter duty rated, indicating a higher insulation level, making it appropriate for VFD application. The phase is listed, either three phase or single phase. A nominal efficiency is given and is defined by the mechanical output power divided by the electrical input power. This rating is given with a range of plus or minus 20% because motor efficiency can vary greatly if the power system is unbalanced. The power factor rating is listed, typically 0.8 to 0.88. This is a ratio of real kilowatt to total power consumption, or KVA, at full load. This is useful for power factor correction design of a large system. Note that the magnetic field is required for the motor to spin, whether it is loaded or not. So when the motor is unloaded, the power factor is very low, about 0.1. And last but not least is the voltage rating. Standard NEMA ratings include 200, 230, and 460 volts. Motors can operate plus or minus 10% of this value. You might be wondering why the values aren't 240 and 480 volts like our power systems are rated. Well, this is because the voltage rating of the motor accounts for voltage drop in the system and stator windings. So you would in fact use a 460 volt motor on a 480 volt system. Typically, multiple voltages are listed like on this nameplate, and you'll see a wiring diagram that you need to follow carefully to connect the stator windings for the high or low voltage rating. Another very important thing to know is that you can reverse the direction of a motor by swapping two of the three phases of the incoming power connection. If you get the phasing wrong, you will have a fan or pump spinning backwards during startup. This is why electricians will bump start a motor for the first energization to check its rotation. Again, motors consume around half of the entire world's electricity. This is why we here at Eaton take motor management very seriously, whether it be our variable frequency motor drives or intelligent control and protection used to manage motor systems. We do our best to maximize efficiency and safety. To learn more about electric motors and their application in power systems, schedule a visit to one of Eaton's Power Systems Experience Centers and check us out online at eaton.com/experience.